welcome to Videoville Church. Tonight, we're doing something a little different, a little bit more in tune with the signs of the times and the generation that we live in. We're looking at some of the events that are soon to happen that we feel more than confident could happen this year or in the years to follow, sometime between 2017 and 2034. Now, it has been announced by NASA and other astronomers that have noticed that there was an unusual occurrence in the heavens, the stars, the skies, the heavens. But out in the universe, apparently there's been a supernova, and there is a star that will suddenly become brighter and brighter and brighter in the year 2022. Now, that's kind of an interesting coincidence, and we're not saying that that is the sign of its coming, but it does happen to fall into the right time frame. And so, some things are coincidental, some things may be directly related. What we want to do in this study is to talk about something else other than 2017 through 2034. We want to talk about the rapture. We want to discuss the things that are true, the things that you think are true, the things that are false, and bring to our understanding the reality of what God is doing in telling us certain facts without us adding our own illusion, our own fallacy, or our own ideas about what we think is being said, as opposed to what the Bible says about the rapture. And the reason I say the Bible says, instead of saying like I normally do, the Word of God, because out there in the world, 90% of people that believe in the pre-trib rapture, as I do, that believe that the event, as we like to call it, this will be called the event 1.1, is that there is going to occur something that popular media, money-making and Bible scholars and all kinds of people have really done a number on, called the rapturos, the snatching away, the gathering in the air, the secret rapture. I mean, people have come up with so many names for just the event that we decided to not call it by any of its names, because no one that I know of calls it by its Hebrew name. That's all. You see, the same word that we use for snatched away, rescued violently, taken violently, or rescued violently, or pulled, or caught up, is also in Hebrew, in the Old Testament. Now, it's interesting that the same word with the same definition is in the Old Testament, not some. But it's interesting, too, is that it's not describing the same event, not exactly the same way. It still involves salvation. It still involves rescuing, it still involves being caught up, but not as the way we describe it in popular media. So tonight, we want to give kind of a brief overview of something that I want you to think about. We're not going to argue about, we're not going to debate it, we're just going to state it. Do you get it? It's something you should consider, because I know when you touch a subject like somebody's favorite idol, or their favorite cookie, or their favorite food, they don't want you to do that. They don't want to know the truth sometimes. They want to believe a lie, because it's easier to accept something that's not true than it is to prove what is true and demonstrate the factual reality that God speaks specifically about what he's going to do, and he says what he means, and he means what he says. Some people call that literal, and I say, no, I'm not a literalist. I can tell you when it's figurative or speculative or metaphor or simile, but we believe in the integral specificity of the word. So that way we know that it has to be the Holy Spirit that gives you eyes to see what's being said here, ears to hear what's being read here, a heart of understanding to know what's being said and read and being comprehended by the Spirit of God, so that your spirit inside connects with his spirit, the Holy Spirit, that you might learn from God and not from man. That's why Jesus said it this way. You have no no need that any man teach you, but the Spirit of God who dwells within you, he will lead you into all truth. He will remind you of all things that I have commanded you. He will cause you to remember. Now, I like that because I'm not saying you shouldn't have a Bible teacher. You should. I'm not saying you shouldn't go to church and have a pastor teaching. You should. I'm not saying you shouldn't go to Sunday school. You should. But what I'm saying is, like tonight, we're meeting in a home. We're meeting, didn't go to church tonight, in a house, in a quiet spot, in a place that's been dedicated unto the Lord in order to serve him in a particular and peculiar way, personal, intimate, real. It's fascinating to me because not only am I doing this recently in the years 2017 onward, but just recently, Randy Stonehill did a concert free over the internet, live, from his home. Other people have begun to do things from their home. Not from the church. Sure, there's still people out there doing that. But they're beginning to see some kind of movement of the Spirit where people are beginning to do things from their intimacy of a house, a home, a place where they call their residence. And that speaks to me of a lot of things prophetically, meaning that I'm not trying to come off as some kind of wacko prophet, but it's interesting that God would use a home for us to bring up something as personal and intimate that the rapture is supposed to be. You see, the event, which is what we're going to call it from now on, we're not going to call it the rapture. Now, I want to clarify again, because that's the biggest problem with trying to talk about something that people already have their ideas about and their golden calves that they want to hang on to with both hands. No. It's not that way. It's this way. Now, it doesn't matter what we say about the truth. If you don't want to believe it, you won't, no matter what. But all I want to do is provoke your thinking so that it can start a process that God can use to cause you to think about. Are you so sure that you're going to be snatched away in the twinkling of an eye and that you're instantly going to be changed and then you meet the Lord in the air, you know, or something similar to that? Do you honestly believe in the fact that if you're sitting in a jet, one of you will be taken, boom, and the jet will crash or have to suddenly, you know, pull itself together? Do you honestly believe you could be driving a car and instantaneously disappear? Because what we call that is rapture disaster. Now, I personally can prove demonstratively to myself and oftentimes to others if I am given a week of constantly talking and comparing scriptures with someone that wants to know, I can show them that the rapture is true. The literal event that we call it, the event. I can prove that and demonstrate that in the scriptures, the event's true. It will happen, even as God has said. But I can also prove that most of what is being said is false. It's pretty obvious that there is no such a thing as a rapture disaster. Nowhere in scripture has there ever been this idea of going, and your clothes are left behind, or going, snap, crackle, pop, and you're out of here, dude. Show me any place in the Old Testament of suddenly disappearing, and I'll show you every place in the New Testament where those sudden disappearances aren't so sudden after all. Because you see, the whole idea of the rapture is more interesting, exaggerated, than it is in reality. Because, in a way, a type of the rapture happens in the book of Acts. A type. Doesn't mean it's the actual rapture or the actual event, because what we're going to say about things like that is that there's things that are similar, we call them similes, there are things that are pointing towards the event, the rapture, like a metaphor, or there are things that are the actual literal statement about the event, the rapture. Most of the scriptures that people use to argue with each other about, meaning that this guy that believes in the pre-trib rapture will argue with this guy about the second coming, will argue about this guy about the mid-trib rapture, will argue about this guy about no rapture. And bluntly, they can all be right, believe it or not, because a lot of times people who believe in the rapture are using second coming scriptures to describe the event, and that's not where or what the rapture is. The event is very specific, and we're going to use that throughout this study. We're going to spend a lot of time dealing with false ideas, because, frankly, until you start to even begin to think straight, understand what the actual literal rapture is. Now, I'm not going to change your opinion at all about the fact that Jesus will call and you will come. Now, that's true. I'm not going to change your opinion about there being some type of event that you'll meet the Lord in the air. I have no problem with those. I have problems with what your idea of what that means as opposed to what the literal Word of God, the Bible itself, says in the Scriptures as we read them. You see, unless you read them as they are, you're going to interpret them for what they're not. And there's no such thing as a personal interpretation, but there's a personal application that the Spirit of God puts to you. So I'm in a disadvantage here because, first of all, who I'm talking to, you've got to believe in the event. Maybe, you know, somebody that's really kind of, you know, on the up and up when it comes to intellect, intelligence, logic, spiritually led by God. Maybe some people will, that listening and obviously viewing, will consider, hey, you know what? That guy makes sense. I think I'll relook at my opinion that there's no rapture. And, you know, they might begin to examine that and then find for themselves, if God wants them to, that there is an event for some Christians. And see, that's another fallacy we have. We have this whole idea that when Jesus said, two shall be taken, one, you know, two shall be in the field, one shall be taken in the, there's somehow this concept that I'm the one. What if you're not the one? Well, no, I am the one, because, you know, I believe in it, and I'm looking for it, and it's going to happen. But, you see, there's a lot of misconceptions about that. When Jesus said that the parable of the 10 virgins were all 10 were looking for the bridegroom coming. And then they heard it, the 10, and then they went out. And then they did what? They were waiting and he's still delayed. Now, some people like to take that to mean only in the past. Now, you know, behold the bridegroom cometh means, you know, back when they first said, you know, back in those 1700s. But what if? And I'm just going to keep saying what if, because one of the things that Jesus did in his teachings, he said if. Paul used the concept a lot on his teachings, but Jesus in the book of Revelation says, he that hath ears to hear, let him hear what the Spirit does it. Using it this way in that letter to the seven churches, because you can't understand it. You won't understand it unless God causes you to understand it. We're told that we should never lean in our own understanding. We're told we should trust in him. We're told that if we would not lean in our own understanding and we would trust in him, that he would direct our path. We are told in James 1:5 that if any man lack wisdom, let him ask of God who abradeth not, but giveth all in the lily. If you go to God and ask him, look, is there a rapture? He'll say, there's an event. You know, and he'll use his own way of describing that, which isn't your way. I'm sorry, but that's why we have a Bible that's so subject to people trying to interpret it. God doesn't speak our way. He speaks the way he chooses. Some people say it's Jewish allegory, or, you know, that Proverbs are kind of like, you know, duality and all these other things. That, well, that's nice if it's just a Jewish book, but what if it's the inspired Word of God? When the Spirit of God needs to understand it. You see, it can be a book of books and left at that if you don't have the Spirit of God. You can read it and not get what you think you're going to get out of it because it depends on if the Spirit of God chooses to allow you to understand it or gives you the ability to understand it. The Bible itself says that the book is spiritually discerned. Sure, intellectually you can go through it and find out all kinds of interesting things. You can come up with a lot of religion and a lot of religious ideas, and you can come up to a very close personal understanding of God. But you can't discern the things of the Spirit where they are spiritually discerned. It has to come from the Spirit of God to your spirit, which you have to have, which means you have to be born again, in order to understand the things of the Spirit. So, in this study, we got to stop right now and tell you, look, if you're not saved, be saved. If you don't have the Holy Spirit, receive the Holy Spirit. If you don't know that you have God in you, or the Spirit of God dwells within you, then receive now the Spirit of God and be born again. That's simple. Hey, you want it, ask, you'll get it. That's how easy it is. You don't have to go through the rigmarole of admitting that you're a sinner and professing with your mouth, confessing and doing all these other things and repressing it out to the public and making sure that you're crusade. That's meant for the church to play with. It's not what God said. God said, hey, if you would follow me, take up your cross and follow me. Yeah, to deny yourself, which is true, but what did he say? Did he say profess with your mouth, confess? No. Those are ideas that have been applied to the salvation experience. Salvation experience is just as simple as grabbing a baby out of the water. Now that baby doesn't know that it needs to be saved, yet it's grabbed out of the water and saved. That can be salvation for some people. Now, admittedly, there is no other way with which a man can be saved except through Jesus Christ our Lord. And so, actually, after that baby pulled out of the water, God spares it. He could save it until it can make a profession of faith. It doesn't get saved because it's a baby. No, all babies don't go to heaven. Sorry, that may have ruined you. Now you may not watch this video. But it's true. There are a lot of false doctrines, false ideas, and false theology about a Jesus I never heard of. Some people tell me that Jesus owns a gun. Never heard of that. That's not my Jesus. Some people tell me that Jesus would tell you to protect your family and your home and your car and your neighbor and your keys and your lifestyle choices and, you know, stand up for the nation and get involved in politics. I'm sorry, that's not the Jesus I know. It's not the Jesus that's in the Word of God. I can demonstrate that simply by telling you to go ask him. He'll answer you. So, when we say all this, we're leading up to these false ideas. Now, I can't say it's wrong to have a false idea. It's not. I'm going to straighten that for a minute. It looks like the wind blew or something. Kind of tilted over. But, oh, it did. Wow, look at that. Kind of moving on. Praise the Lord. I wonder why this one always kind of has wax on the left side. Oh, it tilted over. I didn't even notice. And lots of times I don't notice these things. But what God does in revealing himself is he gives us a purity and a clarity of sight and thought that our first reaction is true, our second is wrong. Peter, going up on the Mount of Transfiguration, says, oh, look, it's Jesus. It's Peter, or Jesus, it's Moses, it's Elijah. Hey, Jesus, I know, let's build a temple. Got news for you, a lot of you people that are looking for the temple to be built, the second temple. You may not want to be looking that hard or looking directly for that. There's something else that it said. It said the oblation would stop. It didn't say the temple would be built. How did the oblation stop? Now that's an interesting study. And we'll get to that, you know, about signs of the times and what people have said and what the Word says. And that's why we're going to examine tonight the rapture. We're going to, from now on, call it the event. This is a beginning overview. It's not meant to be definitive. If you're looking for in-depth studies, it will be it. It'll be on Sunday nights, it looks like. It'll probably be under candlelight. We won't have any other light, you know, but we want to, by the light of the candle, you know, examine the scriptures according to what they say. I just love the kind of, you know, reflective way that the candles go upon the pages of the Bible. Just personal preference. Nothing spiritual about it or abnormal or weird or holy. So, the one thing that people use as a proof text, the absolute, this is it, we're going to look at as what we should do when we look at Scripture. I just want to read it to you because it says, now this, we're going to start at 50, read it down to wherever it ends, and then we'll probably go back and I'll show you the Scripture I want to talk about. The Scripture I want to talk about is simply 53 and 54, I believe. No, 52 and 53. But 52 and 53 says this, okay? And says, in a moment, in the twinkling of an eye, at the last trump, for the trumpet shall sound, and the dead shall be raised incorruptible, and we shall be changed. For this corruptible must put on incorruption, and this mortal must put on immortality. Okay, so that's pretty cool. We go back up, and we look at where it started. It says, behold, I show you a mystery. We shall not all sleep, but we shall all be changed. In a moment, in the twinkling of an eye, at the last trump, for the trumpet shall sound, and the dead shall be raised incorruptible, and we shall be changed. For this corruption must put on incorruption, blah, blah, blah. It goes on and you can read it. This is one of the scriptures used as the rapture. It's used to commemorate, to demonstrate that in a moment, in the twinkling of an eye. But what's it say? Does it say we're going to disappear in a moment, in a twinkling of an eye? That's a legitimate question I'm asking. Because the rapture teaching, the rapture package that we have been sold by fiction books, Christian novels, movies, Thief in the Night, Bible studies, even Hal Lindsey pretty much, you know, maintains the idea that we're going to go bingo, blinking, you know, before there ever is any time pass by, you're gone, baby. You know, you're standing there, boom, you're gone. I have a problem with that. I really do. First of all, my problem started when I read the scripture. I didn't get that out of the scripture. And so I want to stop before I go much farther, because the next step is what I did about when I read this that I was confused about. But we'll just tell you what I was confused about in this scripture, because that'll apply to what Jesus said in Matthew and the other places where you find twinkling of an eye or shall be changed. Listen carefully. In a moment, in the twinkling of an eye. Okay, I get it. There's a moment here and then the twinkling of an eye. Now, boom, that's pretty fast. That's like bingo, bango, bongo. Poof, we're gone. No, not exactly. Listen to what it says. In a moment, in the twinkling of an eye, at the last trump. Something's going to happen fast at the last trump. Can't ignore that. So maybe this isn't about the rapture. But this is one of the ones used. It's 1 Corinthians 15, 52, and 53. Now, we'll just go along with using it for the rapture, because, you know, I'll explain it to you some other time about how people take pieces of the scriptures and take this part out, and they say, well, this is over here, and this is over here, never mind that it's in the sentence, but this is what it means. Remember, I want to keep reiterating this. I believe in the event. I know that I can prove and demonstrate to you that the event is the rapture of the church, let's clarify that. It's not the rapture of the church, so let's just get rid of that. There's no place it says the rapture of the church. No scripture will you find in the Bible that calls it the rapture of the church. Just like people accuse it of not being the rapture, well, the word's there, but, you know, it's not necessarily what people have attached to it to call it the rapture. The word is snatched away, so we want to say the event, so that way we don't get mistaken. So there's an event happening. What the event is, we have to examine to see what it is. One event that's happening, obviously, is at the last trump. So, in a moment, a twinkling of an eye, at the last trump. Those three things are time differentials that are sequencing themselves to apply to an adverbial statement that's saying to you, hey, this is how we describe it. This is where, what it is, this is where it's at, and this is, as we go to the next verse, in a moment, in the twinkling of an eye, at the last trump, colon. Now that's an interesting thing. Probably not in the original text. Don't care. Colon, we'll use just where it is, as it is, and say it's a colon. Full colon. For the trumpet shall sound, and the dead shall be raised incorruptible, and we shall be changed. Full colon just means we're going to repeat this and get real clarity on it. It means we're going to get, again, repeating ourselves, but stating something that applies to the original statement, which is, in a moment, in the twinkling of an eye. So we have a definitive thing going on here that says, literally, that for the trumpet shall sound, and the dead shall be raised incorruptible, and we shall be changed. The dead raised incorruptible means probably that the next part will also apply to the incorruptible. Now, you don't have to agree with that. I'll let you slide on that. But there'll be a change. So there's an event, and there's a change. The event in this verse, which is used as the rapture, don't get me wrong, you can look it up, see if people don't use that. In the moment, in the twinkling of an eye, we shall be changed, basically. And it says at the last note. Now we'll throw that out for you. I mean, why not? I mean, other people do, so we'll just say, only for the sake of debate, or discussion, rather, that it's not at the last trump. Or it is, and it applies then, but it also applies now for other reasons that we'll get into with the other scriptures. But I wanted you to understand what's being said here. It's not saying you're going to be snatched up into the air. No, it doesn't. It doesn't say you're going to be poof and change in an instant, in the twinkling of an eye? Well, yes, it does. As a matter of fact, it says you shall be changed. That's what it's saying in the twinkling of an eye. It's saying the dead in Christ shall be. What does it say? You can read it. I mean, I won't argue with you. For this corruption must put on incorruption, which is in 53, but it says in 54. Then shall it, we'll read it in 52, and it says, and the dead shall be raised incorruptible, and we shall be changed. We shall be changed. That's what I want to leave you with this thought on our first introduction to what we're going to do, so that you don't have to watch anymore. You don't have to watch any more of the event, which is what this is about, the event. You don't have to study with us or examine all the scriptures that we're going to find. Almost all of them, except for a few, are not applying to the Bible. They're made up. They're ideas that were added to the event that is going to be called Natsal in Hebrew, rapture in English, as we use it now because it's a common word, that it's going to mean salvation. It does mean that we're going to be rescued. It means we're going to miss out on the great tribulation. Yes, I agree on all that. I agree that it's pre-trib, meaning that it's before the seven-year period that Daniel spoke of, that the first 3.5 years are a time of peace. It's applying to the 3.5 years also, that afterwards, in the midst of it, that the false Messiah type figure, the false Christ, the Antichrist, will make a treaty with Israel and break it in the midst of it, and then all hell breaks loose because God says, I've had enough. We have now new prophecy people that are making up new ideas that are saying, well, you know, the next thing that comes on the event in the calendar, you know, we're looking at our prophecy calendar, and behold, you know, look, we're going to have the rapture, and then there's going to be a time period where it's going to be a big gap before the tribulation or the great tribulation starts. You think, really? I mean, a gap again? There's no gap. It's like somebody told me there were two creations in the beginning. I went, no, there's not. And then somebody tells me, I mean, a Christian, born-again Christian that's, you know, evangelical and right on, whatever, you know, you probably believe it too, that there's a gap. Because somehow you want to make this a time frame. I don't have any problem with time. I think you'll find that we're going to find out how you can step outside of time and to the world at large appear as though you disappeared. And yet for you, time is still happening, or let me clarify that for you to understand it in a different way. Events are occurring that are outside of the time dimension. Sound weird? I hope so. I hope that just kind of goes, what? Because that's what God exists in, is outside of the time dimension. And we can prove that, you know, basically through quantum physics and study of scriptures. I mean, Nachman, I forget the rabbi, but it's a rabbi Nachman, but he, in Genesis, came up with all the dimensions that now science is still proving that he was right, and we're still figuring out how did he know, because he read it in Genesis. I don't get that out of Genesis, and I'm sure you probably don't, but he spent his entire life studying just Genesis. A Jew, a rabbi. He wasn't out preaching and teaching on Sunday, you know, or Saturday, or whatever, and getting together with his Talmudim. No, he was doing this by candlelight, right there with a scroll, and opened it up and kept thinking, and pondering and wondering and probably writing some things down, you know, and thinking and wondering and pondering and just, you know, God, what is this? How can this be? And he has, I think, 7 dimensions or maybe more dimensions. You can listen to a tape by Chuck Missler and he'll explain it all to you if you really want to know. And I can recommend it to you and you can listen and you'll discover, because we'll probably post that sooner or later. Either the Rapture series by Chuck Missler or the overview of 24 hours of the Bible with Chuck Missler. Because he explains some of the things that you don't know how deep the waters are you're treading when you start talking about prophecy, about the fulfillment of the end of the age, about the time we're living in of the Armageddon generation or the last generation before Jesus returns, the end of the world, as we like to commonly refer to it, or eschatology. Study of last things. But wrapping this up, reread that scripture. Tell me if I'm wrong. Seriously, tell me if I'm missing something there. Think about it later if you want to, without losing your idea. I mean, if you believe in the rapture, then fine, stick with it. I do. I will never change my mind because I've proven it to me. I've proven it by proving what was wrong about what was being said and then proving what was right. And that's how we're starting. We're proving to ourselves in the next lessons or the next time we meet is to look at some of the scriptures, how they speak and what they mean. We're not going to go to the Greek or the Hebrew or, you know, play with the colon or anything like that. We're just going to read it as it is. If God Almighty, the creator of the universe, the master of all things, can't reveal to you the truth, then what the hell are we doing calling ourselves Christian? We're lying. We created a religion of mysticism that follows men and women interpreting a Bible that isn't the Word of God. But you see, that's not what we're saying. We're saying the Spirit of God, by the Word of God, reveals to you Himself, God, that you could understand it in a way that makes sense to you. You will look at, read, and know what it says. Now, the problem with, like I said, the cards stacked against me, the people that will probably crucify me, the ones that are going to say, absolutely not, are likely those that God doesn't want them to know about the rapture or the event. He wants them to know about how to live through the great tribulation, or how to be prepared for the great deception, or how to exist in a time of persecution, how to die as a martyr. He wants them to be prepared too, even though they will not choose to be spared that time of Jacob's trouble that comes upon the entire world. That would be so bad that never had it happened before and never would it happen again. So the things that we want you to remember about this overview are things to think about. Has it ever happened before? Meaning, if you've got a rapture disaster plan where you're planning on seeing, you know, the world fall apart because all these Christians got raptured, what if it's only a few? What if it's only a few? Just remember that, because we'll get into how many people or how few there will be that are raptured. Yes, you can mathematically work that out, believe it or not, from the scripture. We've given plenty. Believe me, it gives you plenty of numbers to put together into a format or a formula that you can pretty much go out there and go to your Pew research and say, well, how many Christians are there, you know, in the world? You know, and kind of subdivided by what Jesus said, subdivided by what he said to, you know, in other places. And when you start narrowing it down, that's not, it's, you know, a lot, but compared to how many millions of people or billions of people there are as Christians, not a lot of people. There's about 7+ billion people in the world. Not all of them are Christian, obviously, but Christianity is one of the largest religions in the world. That doesn't mean everybody that says they're Christian is a Christian. I mean, I'm sure that in the religion, well, no, they don't count Mormons in that, you know, in a few research studies. But, yeah, we'll get into the numbers and details in the coming studies. But to inspire you as the new year starts, and as we have just begun in January, with before the anti-president assumes his position and begins to demonstrate that he really is an anti-president, no, Donald Trump is not the Antichrist, never will be, can't be, no, absolutely not, not going to happen. But we're going to see things that are going to make you want to know more about the event or end times, and you can study and find from this study the way to look at the scripture so that you're not listening to somebody from a book tell you there's a gap, or somebody writing some off the wall, whatever you want to call it, when they claim to be a Jew and they're not. I mean, I've got black Hebrews talking to me, they're not Jewish. I've got yayas and yo-yos and boo-hoos and yahushis and hooies and screwy-looies and all the other things talking to me about why they're Jews and I'm not. I just go, take it, please. If I could get away from it, I'd let you, but that, you know, God doesn't do it that way. I'm sorry, you know, I could be a Jewish if I tried. You know, it doesn't work that way. When you're Jewish, you don't get to deny being Jewish. I mean, that's what's funny, is every Jew goes, why would you want to be a Jew? Boy, are you crazy? You're nuts. And we can't avoid it. But there are people that want to be Jewish for some reason. Now, I don't think it's wrong to study Hebrew roots. I mean, it's the authority, or sort of, you know, it's not really the right one, but, you know, it works. But, you know, I mean, I don't oppose people learning things, doing things, imitating things, trying things, exploring, and finding out for themselves whether it works for them or not. Anything that'll bring you closer to God, hey, try it. See if it works. you're not talking to God, and God isn't talking to you, then you're missing the point of being saved or being a Christian, because that's what the point is. You being able to have conversation, communication, and cooperation with what God's will is for you, and with that basic premise is to have eternal life, which means to know the Son and to know the Father, who He is, to know the Father and to know the Son, whom He has sent. So, in this then, intellectually, just reading the Bible, just read it, just look at it for what it says. And I don't know if the reworked Bibles, you know, all the NIVs to better understand, they might have changed the order, might have, you know, tossed in a few words. So maybe, you know, some of the translations, I don't know if they're different or not. I usually tell people, read anything you want. You know, no matter God, use that Bible. Well, you know, I mean, it still applies. I don't care which Bible you use. I'll explain it to you. Actually come out and said, in the twinkling of an eye, we're going to be caught up into the air, or no, we'll be caught up in the air, and there we will be changed in an instant, in the twinkling of an eye, or in the twinkling of an eye, we're going to be caught up. Because it doesn't say that. And you're going to find that as we look through the scriptures that we study, short of the truth, we're going to not be ashamed, rightly dividing the word of truth. In other words, rightly understanding it by way of asking God to make us able to understand it. So, keeping this short, because obviously, it's late as I'm recording it. I don't know what it is for you, but it's late, and God wanted me to begin this without getting into the details of it. And so I knew that everybody wants the scripture, so we went ahead and grabbed that particular scripture in 1 Corinthians, because, you know, obviously, if you really want to get down to the brass tacks and just tell the truth, that's not about the rapture. Parts of it is what people use to apply to the rapture. Parts of it, you know, I can make it fit the rapture in a way that gives and maintains the integrity of the scripture and still applies to all of the volume of the book, as well as being still applicable to the second coming and apply to the rapture. But frankly, no, that's not what the Bible itself is saying right there in that particular reference. Sorry, it's just talking about changing. That's it. Bottom line. It's talking about when it'll happen, what'll happen, and it talks about changing into incorruption, which means having eternal life. It also pretty much leaves the rapture out because it says at the last trump, which means that those people that are living then at the last trump will be changed, that have gone through, and they too will be caught up with those that were dead. Because obviously the rapture we're talking about is probably something closer to what Jesus was saying in Matthew 24 when we're looking at that. Usually people reference that, and they always say, well, this is how it works. Well, it's an overview. It's not a specifics, because Jesus isn't going to give you the direct specifics of, hey, I'm coming tomorrow. In a way, he does, but then again, a lot of people misapply what Jesus is saying to that generation. And, you know, it says right here, oh, Jerusalem, Jerusalem, thou that kills the prophets and stonest them which are set on thee, how often would I have gathered thee children unto me, even as a hen gathers her children, and her wings, and you would not. Behold, your house is left unto you desolate. For I say unto you, you shall not see me henceforth till you say, blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Cursed. That's why some people don't understand. They're cursed. That's why some people don't get it. Today, my people, Jewish, Israel, don't get it. I have spoken to a Hebrew professor at Hebrew University in Jerusalem on the subject, and he gave a lecture of the Christian view of the Jewish and Christian view of eschatology and end time in regards to the Messiah, Jesus. So the whole lecture was about Jesus and the Christian view. And he spoke of directly the pre-trib rapture. He pretty much stated it. He said, you know, this is what goes on, this is what it is. He stated what's happening in America today, the worship of Christian evangelicals worshiping Israel and using falsely the promise that's for Israel, or well, for actually for Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, but using it falsely for anyone and everyone that happened to be Jewish living in Israel, and that they falsely use it on the land and all the things. I mean, he stated out the case for Christianity and against Christianity and for Jesus as the Messiah and what Jesus was saying, and everything that you would say, well, the guy's got to be a believer. And he says, no, I'm not. He says, if I'm living up to what it says, then when Jesus comes, I'll know. But right now, I can just tell you what it says. He says, I don't have a problem with that. I have a problem with it not being true in those who claim to know him. and they don't do what he said. And I have to agree with him. I can't say that he's wrong because he was the one who said to me, even. He said, Jesus is the Prince of Peace. How can you tell me that your Jesus is going to allow you to kill people? And yet that's what the American Jesus version is. Defense, offense. And he was right. I didn't argue with him. I stood there and I said, yeah, you're right. And then we talked for a while, you know. Had fun with it, you know. And over in Israel, you can have a lot of fun with a lot of things. But, you know, we talked for a long time, you know. And I was amazed by him knowing and still not knowing Messiah, because he told he would not know. And there's other Jewish rabbis now that take that track and that tack to say, hey, when he comes, he'll come and deliver us. Till then, we aren't supposed to know, we don't know. So we're not going to say we know, because otherwise, you know, we don't know. But if we knew, we would say so. But we don't know, so we don't know. And that's part of the scripture that Jesus said. You don't know until you say, blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Messianic Jews, Christians, other people, everyone that's supposed to be saved is supposed to provoke a Jew to jealousy so that they would want what they got. I personally wanted what the people got that I had seen in the church that I went to, Calvary Chapel Riverside. And I said, I want what they got. Can I have some of that? You know, and so they said, yeah, come on up. You know, and so they brought me up in front and they took me into the back room and prayed for me. Never figured that out. How come I was the different, whether it was about four of us or three of us or whatever. But they took us aside. They didn't take us to the front of the altar like they did with everyone else. You gotta ask Greg about that sometime. I should do that. I should pretty much kind of set aside some time to figure out, hey Greg, do you remember teaching in Jonah? Do you remember the one time that you said, you know, did you do that a lot, send people to the back to pray? Or did you just, you know, like, do it that one time? It'd be interesting, because I always wondered, why? Now I had a perfectly unbelievable experience, but still, it was kind of interesting. But that's what we're trying to say about how things get distorted. Jews today do not know Jesus except those that have called upon the name of the Lord to be saved, and God has answered them and saved them. You can have a great revival going on, but it's not going to be with the Gentiles. It'll be in the land of Israel or in like Africa or someplace else. As far as revival is concerned, don't keep praying for one. It ain't going to happen. Sorry, we're not in that time of revival. So, talking about really the subject that we're on, which is the event that we call the rapture, I wanted to find out one scripture, and I was kind of like, well, I just read it, and I thought I found it, and I went, oops, that's not what I thought. So we talked about it anyway, because whatever I was reading, I figured God wanted me to read it, so I went in and spoke on it as though God had said, look, Michael, you know, here we are, why don't you just talk about this? And, okay, well, go for it, Lord. No wonder I'm not there. Okay, turn the page. I have to look up and see what page you have. And then he says, you know, that, you know, in 24, you know, he starts off with all the take heed and no man deceive. Now, I find that fascinating. I'm starting this study on the event, talking about what's wrong with what you believe in, but what's right about the Bible says about the event. So that it's good that you believe in the rapture, that you want to prepare yourself and get ready, but I started off by using a negative to go after what your sacred cow, so to speak, you know, being raptured instantly or being, you know, flying in the air or, you know, being snatched out of thin air, you know, or causing massive rapture disasters and all the other foolishness that people have attached to it. But here's what Jesus does when he's going to say, disciples said, hey, what shall these things be and what shall be the sign of your coming at the end of the world? And of the end of the world. Three different things he's saying. Tell us when these you think shall be, maybe four. When these things shall be, what shall be the sign of your coming, and of the end of the world. Three things. Typical. When you get triunity or trinity or three times, you're getting something being said here, especially of the three different topics. Kind of like the, give you an example, would be in a different subject, but the mark of the beast, the name of the beast, or the number of the thing. That's three different things that can be and apply to you in your forehead or your hand that will condemn you. It's not a computer chip. You could have it written 666 and be condemned. It's a sign of allegiance, is what it is. It doesn't apply now, it will apply then. It doesn't mean that you have to have, you know, some chip to scan it in order to buy food. No, it means that if you don't swear to follow the Antichrist, he's not going to give you any food. He's got to be in control of the food and the water and, you know, kind of businesses and everything else. So you got to have, just like here in America, if you ain't got a green card, same idea. That's what you should get to. The simplicity, not the complexity. Whenever man starts to add things to the simplicity of the Bible, it becomes confusing, and then people can tear it apart when they want. Atheists all the time make mincemeat out of people who believe in the rapture because they don't have an answer. They just adamantly back off and get mad. Well, I'm going to give you answers. I'm going to tell you what you can and can't use. You know, you don't want to use some scripture that doesn't apply. You want to use scriptures that do apply to show and be a testimony of your faith. So when Jesus starts off, he does say this. And he says, the answer to sin is that they want to know three different things. He says, take heed that no man deceive you. Wow. What a way to start a Bible study. You know, I would almost love to say, like Chuck Lester used to say, at his title, say, right on the top of it, don't believe anything that Chuck Lester says. I'd like you to write on top of your notepad, let no man deceive you, you know, or take heed. In other words, pay attention. Be very, very careful. Listen and watch and see. Because, frankly, the scribes and the Pharisees were deceiving. There were people that were saying things and doing things. And, frankly, even we know later on the disciples get deceived in some way. Peter decides, you know, to pick a prophet, you know, or pick an apostle. Pick apostles. Pick a peck of apostles, you know. I should add the apostles, but pick a peck of apostles. And I did. He's there. And you're to do that. Pick a peck of apostles. And he picked apostles, unfortunately, according to what we read and see. Probably not the wisest choice. Might not have been anointed choice, because not everything recorded in there is always the right thing to get. Sometimes it's the wrong thing. Especially in Peter's case. Paul, likewise, he's done some, you know, real loopy loops, you know. It doesn't say him fighting with Barnabas over Mark was the right thing to do. It just says it happened. That's all. Frankly, I know that's not what Paul should have been doing. So do you, if you think about it. So, when Jesus starts off and says, take heed that no man deceive you, he gets into the people saying that this is Jesus and no, or that. It, really, what it says here, if you really want to understand it better, it says, many shall come in my name saying, I'm Christ. Or, really what they're going to say, I'm anointed. I'm the chosen. I'm appointed to tell you. They're not saying only that they're Jesus, because it says they come in his name. In other words, they come as Christians saying, I'm Christ, meaning Christ means anointed. So they're really saying here is that people are going to come up to you and say, hey, I got a word for you. Let me tell you the word. You need to give me $10,000, you know, because Jesus is coming and, you know, you want to get rid of all your goods, so sell me your goods, you know, and then you can go and meet the Lord in the air. No, that's not what it says. He's lying. He's deceiving you. And the deception isn't always evil, though that one is. The deception can be innocent. There are so many books out there on the rapture. So many books about people speculating when it'll happen, why it'll happen, where it's going to happen. Matter of fact, one of the biggest false statements made by Christians today is America is in prophecy. We even have a Jew, stupid, he's just flat out lying and deceiving. But Jonathan Cahn, to put it fairly so that we're not just picking on Jew, but we'll pick on Gentile too, he had Hagee on the one hand and Jonathan Cahn on the other, and neither one of them were right about any of their predictions. Nothing has happened like they said, at all. And yet people are still buying the books, listening to the tape, watching their videos, and still getting excited about what they're saying. And I thought, did anybody pay attention that if you're wrong on the little, you're wrong on the lot, and if you're wrong once, you're always wrong? I mean, that's for profit. So if you're going to get into the area of prophecy, don't say it unless it's going to happen. Otherwise, you're no longer used by the Spirit of God for prophecy. Now, maybe Hagee might be a great Bible teacher on salvation. You know, I think he is. But prophecy? Sorry, he's got some good ideas, and he's got a lot of false, weird, wacko, and he's going farther and farther off on his wrong. Red Moonies, and God knows what else he's gotten into, and that old Tetrods and Red Moonies, and Bilks, you know, had made up something about, oh, I don't know, 20, 30 years ago, and then it came up 20 years ago, and now it came up recently, and then Hagee jumped on it, and Kahn decided to make, you know, America into, you know, a little Jewish rule, and I'm like, hey, let me tell you what I'm going to do. I'm going to make you Jewish. I'm going to tell you that there's a harbinger happening, you know, in the two towers, of course. What better salesman than to attack something that affects most Americans? Didn't bother you, but sorry, I'm just not built that way. But most Americans got all wrapped up in the, oh, wow, the two towers, the two towers. you know, conspiracy theories went one way, Christians went another way, everybody got all excited about it, and then here comes this guy. Let me tell you what it really means. Here it is, you know, the tree of whatever, the harpy. What a false, stupid, mystic joke. It's superstition he threw at you. Jewish superstition, and no Jew falls for it. They look at him and go, huh, you know, I've heard that before. I mean, every rabbi uses stupid stuff to convince people to fall for it. I mean, one of the biggest things in Israel is like, Rabbi, stop with the story. Tell me the point. Because everybody knows they're never going to tell you a straight answer. I know how to do that a lot, but I give straight answers. I mean, I'll tell you straight up what's true or not. You know, say yes is yes and no is no. I'm not going to play the rabbi trick. But Jesus getting into this, it says, you know, they'll deliver you up, they'll go through this, they'll do that, you know, there'll be deception, there'll be all these things. He that shall endure to the end, name called prophet, blah, 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 iniquity will abound, you know, things will wax cold, you know, goes on. And then he gets interesting, he gets farther down, and with his gospel, you know, very well, I don't even want to get into the gospel part, because that's another mistaken idea that somehow we got to preach the gospel before Jesus can come back. No, that's another false idea, we'll get into that later about the rapture. Because when we get into timing, we'll talk about that for you. Because a lot of people actually think that they have to keep going into the furthest, uttermost jungle region so that we can hurry up the Lord's return. Or they even go the opposite way. Well, we're never going to get to Russia, so guess what? You know, can't happen. That's not what it says. The angel, I'll give you the answer. Look in the book of Revelation where it says, this glorious gospel was preached throughout the heavens and the earth by the angel as one of the seals opened. That's the fulfillment of what Jesus said. Kind of like the same thing with the red moon. By the way, did you ever figure out why it's a red moon or bloody moon? It's not multiple bloody moons. It's not all that, but it says, the moon shall be turned to blood and the sun shall be darkened, because it's prophesied in Joel and fulfilled in the book of Revelation. Hey, folks, some idiot yanked it out of context and started making up bloody moons. Well, that's a bloody lie. Sorry. You know that, right? I hope so. Because if you fell for bloody moons, no way you're going to understand about the rapture and all the extra things that have been added onto it. That's why Jesus said, take heed that no man, including me, deceive you. And that's why we command you to study this. We don't want you to listen to what I have to say and go with it. God knows I don't want your mistakes on my conscience. I want you to do as the Lord leads you. Oh, my camera's working. Hello? Can you see me? Oh, maybe I'm kind of like mystic. You know, I'm wondering what the camera looks like now in this kind of light, you know, and I'm going, oh wow, I don't know if I'm actually being picked up, but it's okay. If you can't see me, we'll work on that the next time we get together, and it'll be brighter because we'll have a new camera. But, he says, when therefore you shall see the abomination of desolation spoken of in Daniel the prophet, standing in the holy place, whoso readeth him, let him understand, then let him which be in Judea flee unto the mountain, and let him which is on the housetop not come down, or take anything out of his house, neither let him take that which is in the field and return, blah, 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 one for them that are with child. Notice how we skip over that one. I always find it fascinating. I always say, did any of you guys, when you're reading this, look at the woe unto you that is with child and to them that get stuck on those days? Woe means, oh, how bad it is for you. In other words, you're, pardon the expression, you got to say it, but S out of luck, dear one. Because really, you're going to see babies die. That's not going to be pleasant. That's the way it works in the Great Tribulation. That's what he's talking about, the abomination of desolation. You ain't got time to save anybody. Run for your life. Some people, I guess, they could look at Lot and say, hey, you know, it's not fair. All she did was look. Well, yeah, on the one hand, but she was also told, don't look. You get what you pay for, and that's what Jesus said. Woe unto you, babies. Don't have babies. That's really what it boils down to. Sorry. Take care of what you got. Don't keep adding more. People are going to die a lot. Matter of fact, world population 7 billion probably wind up with a whole lot less. And we'll talk about that in the study of the rapture. What we call the event. You'll get me to where I'm not saying rapture anymore. Pretty soon. I don't eat tonight. But it says, if any man shall say to you that here's the Christ, or there it is, don't believe it. You know, and he says, except that those days should be short, no man shall perish. You know, we're still kind of getting an overview. You get it yet? It's not. He's already jumped from one part of it to another part of it. Earthquakes, diverse places, these kind of things. He's just giving an overview because they asked three questions. The sign of his coming, all these other things. And then he says, you know, behold, I have told you before, for where they'll show right many false prophets, false Christs, you know, and they will show you great wonders in so much that if it were possible, they should see the very elect. I don't know if you're elect, but I'm pretty much an elect. You know, I'm sorry, I just don't like it, don't want it, don't know how to use it really, I'm still working on it. But you know what, somebody comes up to me and tells me something and I just see right through it. They come up and tell me that, you know, whatever they are, you know, and I see inside them somehow, you know, we would call it normally. Word of wisdom, word of knowledge, gift of prophecy, whatever you want to call it. Discernment of spirits, you know, that's what you know. Really, it's just me asking God, God, what's the story? You know, God, show me. Now, I'm not supposed to react to it, but I do. You know, and that's what he means by the election. If it were possible, they would need to see. I can say, most of you are just in error about the rapture. You're not deceived. It's not like, you know, the rapture is something that's going to send you to hell because you believe in it. Not like what some people that don't believe in it say. But you see, the people that don't believe in it aren't deceived either. So you can't keep beating them up. It was meant to be for those who are looking for his return. It was supposed to be a blessing to some, not a curse to everyone because you're going out there beating everybody over the head with it. Not what it's meant for. So, behold, I told you before, where they shall say unto you, you know, he's here or there or go out or go in the secret chamber, but he is in the secret chamber, believe it not. See? He said, because as lightning comes from the east and shineth even unto the west. Now think about that, from the east to the west. That's one big lightning. It's almost like maybe that's when they part the heavens. But he says, so shall the coming of the Son of Man be. For wherefore the carcass is, there will the eagles be gathered together. Immediately after the tribulation of those days shall the sun be darkened, and the moon shall not give her light, and the stars shall fall from heaven, and the powers of heaven shall be shaken. Then shall appear the Son of the Son of Man returning, you know, and then it's the second coming, obviously. And he shall send his angels with a great sound of trumpet, and they shall gather together his elect from the four corners of the earth. And now learn a parable of fig tree. It's in the fig tree. This generation shall pass away. Heaven and earth shall pass away. But as the days of Noah shall be observed at the time of the coming of the Son of Man. Remember, this is where he starts it. He's talking about what it'll be like. It'll be like the days of Noah. You know, that they what? Whereas in the days that they were before the flood, they were eating and drinking and marrying and giving in marriage until the day that Noah entered into the ark. And knew not until the flood came and took them all away. So shall also the coming of the Son of Man be. Then shall two be in the field, and one shall be taken, and the other left. That's where we start the rapture passage. Whether or not this is the rapture, that's an interesting question. If you thought of Matthew 24 as in order, which it can't be, but if you did think of it, then you just ruined your pre-trib rapture. Part of the reason there are these post-wrath, pre-wrath, in-wrath, by-wrath, some-wrath, whatever-wrath, I don't know. But the reason why they use the word wrath is because they want to change the dialogue to make it into something that you can't defend. So you change the word, trib, to wrath. Well, we're pre-wrath, meaning we're before the bad part, but we're in the good part. But never mind that part, because God doesn't use the word pre-wrath. Doesn't use the word pre-trib either. But we know the event that he's talking about is being described here as most people say, and we'll talk about whether it is or not in another study. I want to give you a listen. Then shall two be in the field, one shall be taken, the other left. Two women shall be grinding at the mill, one shall be taken, and the other left. Watch therefore, for you know not what hour your Lord doth come. But know this, that if the good man of the house had known in what watch the thief would come, he would have watched and would not have suffered his house to be broken up. Therefore, be ye also ready, for in such an hour as ye think not the Son of Man cometh. Who then is the faithful and wise servant, whom the Lord, you know, is made ruler over his household and gives him immediate trouble? Blessed is the servant whom the Lord, when he cometh, shall find so doing. Verily I say unto you that he shall make him ruler over all his goods, but he that rule not, you know, blah, blah, blah. And he says basically the idea that, hey, you know, you don't know when. You don't know what. You don't know how. Be ready. Because if the Satan had known, he would have been ready. He would have prepared. You were supposed to be ready because you don't know what watch. There's a certain gimme put in there. Watch is about a 3-hour stretch through the night. Three or four watches through the night. You know, so anyway. Pre-twilight, but it's through the darkness, you know, and then you're supposed to have someone up on the wall watching in case the enemy comes or something happens or watching for events. Kind of like this, or the Lord's return. But then he goes on to 25 and he says, then shall the kingdom of heaven be like unto 10 virgins, and he gets into the virgins, which you already know, the 5 wise, 5 foolish. And afterwards they came and said, so Lord, let us in. He says, oh no, sorry, watch, for you do not know what day or the hour of the Son of Man returns. But the kingdom of heaven is like, and you go all the way through that, and you go through that, and you get to this, and you get to that. You know, and he says, take it, clothe me, and he talks about the nations, and people use that for only the nations, they don't apply it to the person. But if you're interested, look in there. Look through it. Understand it. Jesus speaking in this part of Matthew 24:25, and show me where it says you'll be snatched away in the twinkling of an eye, immediately caught up into the air, and there'll be a rapture disaster, you know, that happens afterwards. Or, you know, forget the disaster part. Find where you get this, you know, you got to get your ride. Well, actually, I want to use that for, you know, Elijah's chariot. Because let me give you a clue where we're going with all this, just so I can give you a teaser, okay? This is, because remember, I'm not trying to prove anything to you tonight. I'm trying to shake up your complacency about thinking you know about the rapture. And I'm very much a scholar when it comes to the rapture. I'm sorry, I've been around a long time. You can tell me about Thomas Ice and all the other guys, you know, that you think is nicer, you know, Lindsay. Yeah, I like Hal. Hal's pretty open still, also, to even learning more. But the bottom line is simply, Hal set the pace when he wrote The Late Great Flat Earth, and he's still using it. I mean, it's still applied. But frankly, all he had to do and all he did was just read the Bible and put it in a book. That's all he did. That's all you have to do. You don't have to be ignorant. You don't have to be stupid. You don't have to follow me. You just have to read. Read it. And let God be. Because if you're going after it to find out about the event only, which is fine, we'll help you. I really am going after the event and then trying to show you things about how God operates and why people are deceiving you, and how you can even believe by deception that somehow you should have a gun. You can only make other points about this in the event. The Jesus in America is not the Jesus in the Bible. The Jesus in America is not the one being preached that God has revealed to us in the Word of God. The Prince of Peace is the Prince of Peace. He would never be caught up with a sword or a gun or a knife or anything else that you might think of to take a life. He saves lives by giving up his own. And that's what we're called to do. So, with this study of the event, something is going to happen. But the teaser is this. What is the teaser? I already forgot. I went up on a tangent. What's the teaser, Lord? I don't know. The teaser. We're going to say it. I'll give you a hint about where we're going. There's definitely no doubt that the event is going to happen. There is no doubt that there is an event that is similar to what you believe in. It's called the pre-trib rapture. That I do believe that it happens before the small tribulations that go on, the great tribulation that goes on, before the 7-year period. There's no gap between what happens then and what happens now. Yes, we're probably coming up to Ezekiel 38 war or whatever, war with Russia, the Gog Magog war. No, there's no Psalm 83 war. Sorry, there's nothing in there called the war. It's a prayer. Gosh. People look at something and they jump up and down and get excited, like Nostradamus. How many times have you been told that Nostradamus fits today? Oh boy, I mean, by God, that guy had to have been a genius, because over and over again they're bringing up Nostradamus. Pretty soon they're going to bring up the Mayan calendar again. They can't, but they're going to try. Somebody will. Or Enoch. I mean, how many times do you get the Enochian way of looking at the Bible? Enoch's a book that's false. So there's a lot of false things out there, and there's a lot of ideas that were meant to somehow communicate to you in a simple way so you understand to look for the Lord's return. And so that helps you to get to the place of knowing about a future rapture. But even Jenkins and, you know, LaHaye, you know, they kind of indulge themselves in a little bit of fantasy writing by making things bigger than they are. And now you see it in the movies, you know, like, oh, we're flying a plane. Oh, the pilot disappeared. Oh, God, the crash. No. What if? Yeah, I told my wife this, and she kind of bought it. And I went, well, you know, that's interesting. My wife, she don't buy anything I'd have to say. My one sister doesn't believe a word I say. You know, later on she'll tell me she believes it, but, you know, it's like, she didn't believe it right off the bat. It takes her a long time to accept anything I have to say. So, with the rapture, now this isn't something new. I've been teaching this for about 40 years, but here, look at the book of Acts. The book of Acts is what we're using as our group text, and see what happens with Peter locked up in the prison. But I'm serious. Go back and look at the prison because that's what's going to give you the teaser for what we're saying about how and where we're proceeding with what happens in the event, blow by blow in detail. You can look at the book of Acts with Peter and find out pretty clear what's going to happen. And then it makes all these other scriptures fit, even in context. Because we're going to talk about something, going to have to just watch TV or listen to your kids, you know, that have read comic books or sci-fi, and we're going to talk about something called the time continuum, sort of like what they say on TV. It's not that, but, you know, the time dimension, the quantum physics about how time can be, and I'll give it to you from the Old Testament, how time can be moved backwards. Now, God did something about time that wasn't moving it backwards. He did something that no one else in the universe could ever believe would happen. He turned the sun backwards. I mean, you read Joshua, haven't you? When he said, God, we need more time. Turn the sun back. And it says that he turned it back on the sundial, meaning that the way they kept track was that, you know, sundials in those days, so it moved back so many degrees. You can't make the sun go backwards. You can't make the earth change its rotation. God did. Now, that isn't what we're talking about. That was something that was like, cool. Well, then maybe when they say the mountains will flee, I think I'll believe the mountains will flee. Because after all, that's not an allegory. God made the sun turn back. That wasn't a metaphor. He did make the earth stop in rotation or go backwards in rotation. Man, I would like to have flushed the toilet that time. People went this way or that way, spinning around to the left. If you figure that one out, you know what I'm talking about. So, anyways, read Peter. Peter has an interesting event happen to him. Nowhere else is something like that. Well, yes, something else is recorded like that. And I'll give it to you, but it won't really connect the dots, I guess. The resurrection. The resurrection that happened. Well, what happened with the guards? Where did they go? How come they didn't see it? What happened with them? Did they suddenly just, like, you know, lose their mind or something? Did they see a bright light? Were they, like, brainwashed? And then, you know, like on the, I don't know, that spy show where he blasts them with some kind of like little zapper and their memory is forgotten? Or he just says, forget it, you know? Or did it happen right there, and yet they weren't right there in the same space or the same dimension at the same time? Interesting. Why can't we see the kingdom of God all about us? Why do angels come and go, we're told, and we don't see them at all? Don't tell me you're seeing angels. God knows I got enough people telling me that they see angels and that Jesus is Michael and all kinds of weirdo wacko things. That's not what we're talking about. We're talking about Jesus said the kingdom of heaven is about you and it's within you, and it's just simply the way he says it in the Hebrew means it's everywhere, but it's another dimension, another reality. It's something that's here right now. Just like if you're, we'll use it this way, if you're in Star Trek, they use the same thing right out of the Bible, the original Star Trek with William Shatner. They said the vibrations of your atoms move at a certain speed. They oscillate in a certain rhythmic pattern. And I'm sure you've heard this before about sound waves and everything else. But anyways, my body right now is going, me. You see me. If I went, me, you wouldn't see me. I'd disappear. My oscillation of the atoms that exist where my body is and everything that I am would suddenly have been so fast, you would no longer see me. Because you're only able to see the things about you in this dimension at a certain oscillating rate. Now, people have used that to be weirdo and wacko and whatever, but it explains for you to understand what happened with Peter in the book of Acts, what happened with Jesus at the resurrection, meaning that, you know, why the guards could have been there and said, well, wait a minute, what happened? Where'd he go? It also explains how come Jesus could appear in their midst and then disappear. Now, you may say that that applies to the rapture, but it doesn't use the word rapture. It doesn't say that he appeared, but he says he appeared in their midst. In other words, he didn't just suddenly go poof, but he's right there in the midst of them. So it's not a rapture thing, but yeah, you could try to use that for the rapture and make it like twinkling on eye snatched away. Won't fit, but you could try, and I'll go with you on that to show you some of the other things that can be applied if you want to make a mistake. But really, I don't want to keep going on just the errors. I want to move forward into the beauty of the beauty of the revelation of the event, meaning that there's a reason it's called the event. There's a reason why it's called snatched away. There's a reason studying, preparing yourself for, and then looking for the soon return of Jesus. So that not only would you be ready, willing, and able when you hear the call, because he's liable to call you by name. Show you. Go outside. Look out. Look at the stars. Come on. What happened to the shepherds? They're not sending their sheep. And women run down to the cave. How come she sees an angel? Well, why do we have discrepancies supposedly in the Bible when these are not discrepancies at all? If you explain it from a different point of view, God's and ours, then there's no discrepancies. It's a perfect time frame continuum problem or issue that you don't realize. This happens then, this happens then, this happens then, this happens then. It all fits together. Because what happened before will happen now and will happen hereafter. What was, is, and ever shall be. That which seen, heard, and handled with their own hands. Three parts. And most people are only talking about myths, legends, superstitions about the rapture. I want to address the superstitions of the rapture before we talk about the reality of the event that's going to happen very soon. Could happen even this year. Could happen even before you open the door to your new day tomorrow. So don't be surprised in the night, tonight, that God called you away to go out in the night and to just stand there and look up in the sky and wonder why God saved you and why were you created and what does God have for you?